what the Word of God says.
Amen. Hallelujah.
It's not going to change. The Word is not going to change. We just have to measure up to it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How many else, who else had visions? I want you to tell your visions.
Yeah, I had a vision during worship, and it was so beautiful. And I saw the Lord putting his flaming swords into our hands, and I knew it was the Word of God. And that faith was just so filling us that we would know the power of it, even one word from the Word of God, it was going to take down the enemy. And later on during the meeting, I saw like these big hot air balloons, and they were hideous. All the powers of darkness. And the Lord was showing me that there were compartments of hot air in them, holding them up. But as the Word of God went forth, it was like deflating them. Deflating them until they were just destroyed. And then, Sister Ruth, when you spoke about the camels, I saw the Lord, I saw you climbing up on the camel. And I saw the camel's eyes, and they were so beautiful. And you had eyes that were a cross between camel's eyes and dove's eyes. And the Lord was on that camel with you. It was like he was the camel, but he was also the bridegroom. And you were his bride. And you were kind of like in this camel-colored garment. And I saw him take his tallith, and it was over his head. And he brought it across your mouth. And he was shutting you in with him so that your prayers became his prayers, and you were leaning against his chest and just hearing his heartbeat. And then just a little bit ago, I just heard a little part of this scripture, and I feel like it's a prophetic word for the church for this day. And the Lord said that I am preparing my bride. If I prepare her, will she not be perfect and spotless? Oh, will she not be filled with my glory and my power? For everything I have is yours, says the Lord. Everything I have, oh, I've prepared for my bride, that we might be one as I and the Father are one. Every word that I have spoken shall come to pass, says the Lord. Every word is a flaming sword that will defeat all your enemies. The Lord is saying, fear not, fear not, fear not. And this is just a short psalm. It's so beautiful. It's Psalm 126, and it's called a song of ascents. And I feel like during these prayer meetings, the Lord is bringing us up closer and closer and closer to him. It says, when the Lord brought back the captivity of Zion, we were like those who dream. Then our mouth was filled with laughter, and our tongue was singing. And they said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us, and we are glad. Bring back our captivity, O Lord, as streams in the south. Those that sow in tears shall reap in joy. He who continually goes forth weeping, bearing seed for sowing, shall doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing his sheaves with him.
Those that sows in tears shall reap in joy. Those that sows in tears shall reap in joy. Those that sows in tears shall reap in joy, they shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves. Sow in tears, shall reap in joy, they shall come rejoicing with the sheaves. They shall come, they shall come, they shall come, they shall come. Oh, they shall come, they shall come, rejoicing, bringing the sheaves. Oh, they shall come, oh, they shall come. One of our household, we have a generation. They shall come, oh, they shall come. They shall come, bringing in the sheaves. They shall come, they shall come, they shall come, bringing in the sheaves. They shall come, they shall come, they shall come. Tile, he's got to shore it up. The Bible talks about shoring up our prayer life, our fasting life, reading the word. The Lord's moving faster than the speed of sound. That's what you were saying. He's faster than you can think. He's way ahead of you. What you're thinking, he's already gone ahead of you and put it in order. He's already done it.
Amen.
You've got to see that. He's already done it. Hallelujah. Woo! And so, listen, you got to want to see. And I'm telling you, I know how it is. I remember I used to want to see and I didn't see nothing. And I used to get so frustrated. And one day I said to the Lord, I'm going to pay my tithes. I'm going to church just like you asked. And I can't do any more because I don't see a thing. Right. And it went on for a long time. And when I got the Holy Ghost, I thought the Lord would come before I got the Holy Ghost. And I got desperate. And I went to visit a friend after I got off from work one day. And when she opened her door, she said she saw the desperation on my face. And she put her hand on my head and said, speak in tongues, I say in the name of Jesus. And I spoke for 2 hours. That was my first experience of speaking in tongues. How many of you pray in tongues every day? I'm not trying to put you on the spot. I mean, pray until you have to go start all over again. Work it out. Lord, I'm working on their building now. I'm working on Tom's building now. I'm working on Joy's building now. Lord, I'm working on Rachel's building now. Come on, call them by name. I'm working on Central Avenue right now. I see myself going up down Central Avenue and calling these people out of their homes. I see myself doing that. You understand what I'm saying? The Lord said he's going to what? Restore. How many want him to do a new work? Now listen, it doesn't feel too good. My father was a builder. I have 2 nephews that ended up with building businesses. They both ended up being very wealthy. But I remember my father's hands were so, his knuckles were so big from using that hammer. But I never complained for what my dad couldn't give me. I used to thank the Lord. I said, he gets up every morning, Father, and he doesn't complain, and he goes out, that he can bring the bread and the food on the tables and pay the electric bill and put clothes on my back. These people that complain, I never have a father, I don't have this and don't have that. They're spoiled brats thinking only of themselves. I never did that. My father never sent me on his lap. He may have when I was a baby and said, oh, I love you so much. And I didn't get upset because he didn't. Because I remember he got up in the snow and the rain and the cold. And he went out to work every day. He never had a sick day to take care of his family. You understand what I'm saying? So the Lord doesn't look at any elements or storms or wars. He doesn't get a frown on his face when there's a war here or an outbreak here or this happens over here. I don't think he got upset when he saw what he saw. He didn't. He doesn't have to. He knows how to take care of it in a moment. All he wants us to do is obey him and love him. And we need to get more into the loving part. Jesus said, if I told you today how much I loved you. Lord, I just want to tell you how much I love you. You won't say it but a couple of times and you'll start crying. If you don't, ask him to make you cry. Hallelujah. Because he's so wonderful. And I love my father. And I love my mother. They raised 9 children. And I don't remember them ever being without a nice table and clean clothes. You understand? It took work to raise 9 children. That was my mother's feel. That's the feel of those parents. Your children are your feel. Don't get upset because you can't go to work. Take care of the children first. The Lord told my mother that. Her children were her feel. Take care of what God, and I don't care what he gives you. If that's your feel, take care of it. If your feel is to move into a neighborhood and get them saved. Lord, I'm not going to give up till you save this whole neighborhood around me. Come on, you got to mean business. Lord, I'm knocking on your door. These people need to be saved. Well, What can I do to help you? And he'll put a little thought. Go over and visit him. Take him a hot dish. Come on. Ask him if there's anything you can do for them. But you love them so much because God loves them as much. Listen, that'll break down every wall. You understand what I'm saying? How many understand? You got to be bold. I've done some things. That's how I've lived. Do you understand? It's how I've lived. That's how I got furniture in my house. I saw a picture in a magazine of Better Homes and Gardens, and I thought, oh, God will never give me that. I know that. I'll never have enough money, and if I did, I wouldn't spend it on that. I'm telling the Lord this one day. I'm looking at this beautiful picture of blue and white furniture. Antique. And I said, well, it's all right. I don't have it. I won't get upset. But God heard me say, he probably wouldn't give me that. And listen, he started to work on that dream as soon as I said it. And it started like this. If you see so-and-so today, will you go with them wherever they're going? He said that to me. I thought, I'll never see them. They're 1,000 miles away. I go into a prayer meeting and they come in and sit right down behind me. And the chair was open like this and I felt something tickling me in the back. And it was a note. I'm going to North Carolina today. Would you like to go with me? Honey, there was no time to go back home and get a suitcase. Not even a comb to comb my hair. Not even a toothbrush. We're talking about a couple hundred miles. And all I could say was yes, because the Lord said, if you see this person today, we drive 200 miles. I don't have even a credit card to buy a comb or a toothbrush. No money. I'm in her car with her. We drive up in front of this house, and I had a vision of the mailbox full of bills. Bills. And we go in the house, and it was everything in Better Homes and Gardens. I didn't connect it. Are you listening? They'd spent a lot of money matching the wallpaper with the lampshades, with the bedspreads, with the trash cans, with the carpet. Can you get it? They were lawyers. And they were in dire need. And we drove 200 miles to go pray for these people. That's what we were doing there. They'd call for help. And I said, I see your mailbox full of bills. And the woman broke down and wept. You want to hear the end of the story?
Yeah.
A friend of mine bought all of their furniture to help them from Better Homes and Gardens. Guess who got the furniture? It was antique mirrors that went this high. Woo! Marble on the sides of the dressers. It was a fainting couch in silk blue butterfly. And a chair to match it. Then another chair that was blue velvet. It's where you sit on the edge of the chair. You don't sit and you drink tea in high places. That's what this furniture was for. What am I going to do with it? You know how I got it? Sister Ruth didn't want it because her friend didn't like it after she bought it. So she asked me if I knew anybody that would like it. And I thought of someone that loved antiques, so I called him up and told him. And she came and bought the furniture. Took care of that. Never thinking God was going to give it to me. And the next day, the person called me up and said, did you get it? I said, get what? The furniture. What furniture? The antique furniture that Sister Ruth is selling. I bought it. And I told her to give it to you. Whoa! I can't even jump up. I'm too old now. And it was those three pieces of that furniture I sold from my money to get out of here.
Wow.
I said, so much for Better Homes and Gardens. I'm just telling you, all the furniture in my house has come that way. I don't know the joy of going out. I think I bought two lamps. Buy two nice lamps and some pretty curtains. It'll make your house. I bought me two of those, like, what are those real expensive? Tiffany. They're like Tiffany. If you see it advertised, it's called like Tiffany. So I bought two lamps and put them on time payments of $15 a month. That's about the only thing I bought in my house. Come on. Somebody brought me a screen from Japan. Somebody sent to Israel and bought me a $400 menorah. It's only this big. The Star of David is not the emblem of Israel. The menorah is. Do you want to know why?
Sure.
Richard should know this. Because they have seven candlesticks. And the seven churches of Asia represented the church of God. And they have seven candlesticks on. There's seven. So we're connected to Israel because of the seven candlesticks on the menorah. We're part of the seven churches. But it is not the Star of David. And the Jews will tell you that. It's the menorah. And they've got one that is 20 feet high and 30 feet wide in front of the Knesset in Israel. The menorah. And I'm sitting in my house one day. I'm going to let you go, but I'm giving you some education. I thought, I need something else in my house. Now, I really don't. You know that. People have brought me so much stuff, I keep moving it around to be comfortable. All that you see, the rug on the floor, you've been in my house. Somebody gave me the piano. Somebody gave me. The divider, somebody gave me. The couch you sit on, somebody gave me. Oh, I did buy a rocker. Everything. The television, somebody brought there one day. The stand that it's on, somebody brought it. The chairs at the bar, somebody brought it. The table in my kitchen, somebody brought it to me. The bed, my mother left me. The furniture in my bedroom, somebody gave me piece by piece. The house that I left, the furniture came from all over the world. My house was built with furniture from all over the world. I left in Virginia. Let the Lord do it. He's a fine decorator. How many know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Now, I know there's things that you want. Don't worry. It'll be in your mansion in heaven. Don't worry. It'll be of gold and silver. But when I was sitting there, I said, I need something else. Something's missing from my house, the Lord said, a menorah. I want to recommend you all get one of some type. Now, they're going to be expensive, even if you buy a little one. They cost a lot here. If you go to Israel, you can barter with them and get you a nice one for a fair amount of money. It won't cost you much. Put it in your window. I wished I had a picture window. I'd stick one right up there for everybody to see. Vlad Svanar said, the key to what is happening has to do with Israel. But he said he's been very, the word that he used was very, not confused. What did he say? He was very frustrated because he can't get a hold of the key of what's happening now, but it has to do with Israel. It always has to do with Israel. That's where it started. That's where it's going to end. We can't do anything until God does what he wants to do in Israel. And it's very quiet right now. Some of you, but Daystar and TBN have built themselves a place there because they were smart. And most of these ministries are finding out they're to have a place in Israel. And we haven't talked about it. We need to sing about it right now. And we'll let you go. But you that have not been to Israel, how many have not been to Israel? Now listen. Sell something. Make a sacrifice. Tell the Lord you've got to go or you'll just die. You'll just die. Thank you for coming. So glad you came. Tell the Lord you want to go. Now, you don't see the need for it, but I'm telling you, it's a place of revelation, and the spirit of revelation will come upon you when you go. How many have not been? It's not hard for God to get the money. Just get a passport and show the Lord you want to go. And I'll guarantee you, Jensen Franklin's got a tour going in June. I may go between March and April. I don't really like going during the Passover because they close a lot of stores. I was in Israel last time I went, and then I never got any Shabbat bread. They shut everything down during Passover. But I didn't get any bread. I had to eat matzah. You know, it's got all the little holes in it that has to do with the holes in the Lord's hands. You need to track that one down. But the Jews are shut down now. And a lot of people won't buy from the Arabs. Listen, I'd buy from a turkey if they had it. You just do what you have to do. But we walked everywhere. I'm dragging my leg. My hip is out. I walked up and down the hills, and I don't know how I did it. But I walked the land. Abraham walked the land. When it says Abraham was looking for a city, what was he looking for? How many of you know what he was looking for?
Whose builder and maker was God?
Yeah, but what was he looking for? He was looking for the bride of Christ. Remember John said, let me show you who the bride is? He saw the New Jerusalem coming down. The Bible calls it the city of God. That calls it the joy of the whole earth. When you see the plan of God is all in what he does in Israel. God, I pray that you'll let him fall in love with her. A man told me that when I went there. He said, what is it? Everybody wants to have a love affair with Jerusalem. There's an anointing that comes that you don't want to leave her. I'll guarantee you, when you get ready to come home, you'll cry. Steve and Lori know what I'm talking about. They took all of their alms and put it in a basket one year and went up. They were under the radar, traveling all over Israel for the Lord. You won't want to come home. I didn't want to come home. I cried and said, God, can't you do something to keep me here? You know how to do anything. Can you keep me here? But I wasn't ready for what would be required of me in Israel. It's a place where you don't make mistakes. But Cheryl and another girl, myself, went to Israel. I tell you, it wasn't easy getting started, but we laughed. We laughed until we couldn't laugh anymore because we knew God was doing a makeover on us, wasn't he? Makeover. Now, I'm going to release your faith right now. And don't look at yourself like you can't go. God can do anything. He made you, didn't he?
Amen.
Any of you mothers ever wondered when you gave birth, wonder what this one's going to look like? I wondered that about myself. Did my mother wonder if I was going to be the one that was going to preach the gospel out of the whole family? I was the oddball of the whole family. I was the black sheep, man. I was running everywhere trying to get a hold of God. Hallelujah. Now, I'm seeing a vision that God's going to make some of you like a violin. Who in here wants to play a violin? I know you do because I see a vision of it. I'm seeing it. You want to play a violin? Piano. Well, you got an old piano in your house? Got to get one. Buy you, it won't cost much. Lay it away. Bring it home and I can show you how to play. I know enough chords that you can play a few songs. You only need 3 chords to play a song. Then you can add the rest to it. But we're going to sing for Israel. Cynthia, raise your hand. She's been there so many times. It's growing out of her like branches. She's did archaeological work.
I didn't want to leave.
No. I'm telling you, it's something that happens because that's home. You've got to understand, Israel is home. It's where did you know the bride? Not everybody's going to live in the New Jerusalem. Only the bride is. And others can live in Israel, but in the New Jerusalem. The bride's going to live in the new city, that holy city. It's the only place on earth God's put his name. It's called the city of God, Jerusalem is. It's called a house of prayer. It's called a city of righteousness. is called a city of truth. Because God works his plans there. What he's doing in the earth, he starts there. He gives. Remember, he said, shall I do this thing and not tell Abraham? He doesn't do it until Israel is informed first. There's a revelation for you. So when you go there, I just want to say this one more thing. We had music like you've never heard. We've had it here a few times, Richard. You know that? It was like that wheel in the middle of the wheel got to turning. When you read that in Ezekiel, the wheel in the middle of the wheel, it's the movements of God in you and me when we enter into the glory. And sometimes we don't know what it is, but then things begin to unfold like a flag unfurling. And you think, what is it? You caught something. And when you look at our flag, we got the most beautiful flag in the world. I don't care what all the other countries say. It's just, it's a beautiful flag. It's red, white, and blue. It's got spirit. It's got blood. It's got life on it in this country. And there's a few people that's paid a price, and God's not going to let it go down the tube. People have prayed. They've given up their sons and daughters all over the world. Are you listening? We've given our bed baskets all over the world. We've built cities here and there. We've restored countries we didn't even have to fool with. But we always did the better thing because we were upright in our thinking in those areas. But I want to tell you, God wants to birth Israel in your heart. And the first time I heard this song, Havana Nagila, I didn't know what it was, but I knew it had to do with the country, and I had to have something to do with the country. The song right here. I'm jumping up and down going, da-da, da-da-da-da, da-da-da. And I get into Israel, and we're checking out to come home, and the Lord spoke to me. He said, I want you to get off of this bus, and we were in a remote place. It was our last stop getting out of town. He said, I want you to get your tambourine, get off of this bus, and dance for me. That's what he said. I thought nobody else heard that, so I don't have to do it. And God speaks to another lady. Help her. I've told her to get off the bus and take her tambourine and dance for me. Remember, I had asked the Lord to help me identify with the people. I'm in front of a building on the bus. Alphabetical order, my name starts with a C, so I'm one of the beginners. You get checked through the checkpoint, and then you get back on the bus. You're not checked anymore. You're going to the airport. I got off the bus. I didn't know this song. You can play it while I'm saying this. Have a nagino. And I start with the tambourine, and I'm jumping up and down. Da 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 da. I'm just jumping up and down. And my friend is with me with her tambourine. She's black and I'm white. All of a sudden, I heard a noise. And there was a whole battalion of soldiers. They were down under a bunker because they were there on the checkpoint, watching the people, making sure they didn't act up. And they got their rifles in their hands, dancing with me. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. What is this? And then I remember God said, identify with the people. I'm doing what the Israelis do. They dance and sing their Israeli songs. So go home and get some Israeli songs, dance to them. That's your seed that you're planting to go to Israel. And you tell the Lord, Lord, you can't take other people without me. I know you can, but I don't want you to. I got to go to Israel. Lord, please. Give me my inheritance. You all have inheritance in Israel. You got to know this. If you don't, you won't have your part in that day. You got to know this. I remember standing at that wall, and I'm speaking in tongues, and I want to know, what language is this? I'm trying to explain the Godhead without getting them confused. They don't read Bibles. They're reading a book given to them to read. Okay? You want to be able to go in there and leave something with those Jewish people. And I remember I get on an airplane on LL, and a man put his fingers on like this on my cheeks. And he said, "You're Jewish, aren't you? Tell me you are." Said, "You are, aren't you? You are." This happened 3 times where they grabbed me by my face. I said, "Well, I got a Jewish heart." They laughed because they don't know how to come back on that. I love Israel. And I cried and cried. I said, "God," he didn't answer me. He didn't give me a dream. It wasn't my time to stay there. I've traveled all over Israel from the top to the bottom. I've been in almost every city. But all I have to do is cry a little bit to God and say, "Lord, I need to go to Israel. Lord, I'm not going to be happy until I go to Israel." Hallelujah. Now, Lord, we're going to dance for you. We're going to sing for you.
In the race, in Israel, gonna take my place.
listen, ask the Lord to put a love in your heart if you don't have it. And say, now, Lord, you own all the money.
Amen.
You own all the airlines.
Yeah, you do, Lord.
Surely there's a seat on that airline for me. Are you listening to me?
Yes, Lord.
I tell you, he wants to do crazy miracles for you.
Yeah.
Crazy.
Yes.
He said this with the Baptist tour. Boy, did we get shook up. Lean. I want to get a harvest. And I'm telling you, the first thing you want to do when you get saved is go to Israel.
Yeah.
Don't be late, Mr. Higgins. Catherine Herron in My Fair Lady said, just you wait, Mr. Wiggins. I heard that in prophetically the Lord say that to me when Trump didn't win. Just you wait. I thought, where have I heard that? They were taking advantage of her, and it hurt her pride. She was a flower girl that couldn't speak good British, and they made a bet, these two. What do you call them? They don't marry late in life. Bachelors. They made a bet that they could make a lady out of her, and she didn't know it. And when she found out, it hurt her pride. And she sang this song, just you wait, Mr. Wiggins. I'm going to get even with you, in other words. I heard that when Trump didn't go into office, and I couldn't remember where I heard it. It's from My Fair Lady. My Fair Lady. I want you to listen. God, let their ears hear what the Spirit is saying. Little things, Lord, that are like nuggets, bringing the pieces of the vision together, bringing the answer together, bringing it together. Listen to me, bringing it together. My pastors, I had two of them had more trouble with me, not because I was arrogant or resistant, but I would go and tell them things, and they said, what did you hear? It didn't make sense, but it was the mysteries unfolding. He wants us to know the mysteries of the gospel. There are, how many mysteries in the Bible Paul talked about? There's a lot of them, but there's
probably unlimited.
Well, it is, but he talks about there's seven mysteries. The bride is one of them. You're a mystery to the world. Hallelujah. And I'm telling you, if you want to go, you don't need money in the bank. You need faith in God. And he wants you to go. And he'll start preparing you. Suddenly somebody will give you a new dress or a nice pair of walking shoes. Or they'll give you a suitcase. They'll just put a little money in your hand you didn't expect. It might start with $20. Don't spend it. I sold all of my clothes from my first trip to Israel. I had a lot of clothes, so I sold them. I had closets of clothes. And I sold them, and I got enough. And somebody gave me a Samsonite. This was before they had wheels. Do you know what? This big. That was my suitcase going to Israel. Come on, get the message. Don't take a whole lot. You're not going to be in the same place very long. Just see the same faces every day. Say, Lord, I'll just die if you don't let me go to Israel. You will. You'll die. And listen, it doesn't matter if it's 5,000 or 3,000, God will. He will perform. I walked in here today and you're singing, he's the miracle worker. Come on. How many of you believe it? I didn't have any money, but God showed me how to get on that trip. And we not only went there, but we went to Egypt. And we also went to Italy. And I also went to that rose red city. What is it? Outside of Jerusalem where the Jews are going to hide during the tribulation.
Petra.
Went to Petra. We had to ride on horses in there.
Wow.
So small getting in there. It's below sea level. And the reason why, it's going to be a hiding place because the Dead Sea is going to dry up and the Jews are going to go through the Dead Sea and they won't be able to find their footprints because of the marshy places. The Dead Sea has already decreased 35 feet over a period of about 40 years. 35 feet. That's taller than this building. Oh yeah, it's already dried up. The Bible says they're going to go through marshy places to be hidden from their enemies, and they're going to hide them in Petra. Some of you don't know that. It's called the Rose Red City. It's already been carved out in some places because people used to live there. The goats live there now. It's got high walls on both sides, and a jeep or horses can barely get through the road to get in there. And as high as you can see, it's the most beautiful carved out. It's called Rose Red because all of the stone looks like it's rose red. And it's got a lot of caves in there. But it's got a treasury house carved in there. It's here from 2,000 or 3,000 years ago. They carved it into the rock. I mean, it looks like a treasury house. Did you all go to Petra?
No.
It's a place you want to visit. You're moving in history. God, I thank you. You'll open a door that no man can shut. You will cause them to be favored by someone. Send them to Israel, Lord. Send them. Let it be the place of their birthing. Woo! The place of their enlargement. The place of receiving their atonement. This is what they were made for. Some of you will ride on camels getting in there. Some on horses. It's mainly, it's too far to walk. You can't walk back in there when you get off the bus. But they have horses for you. You should have seen us in our dresses trying to ride the horses. We did it. Mr. Wiggins, we did it. And God, I thank you. You'll give them a handful here. You'll get them a seat on that plane. I decree it right now that you're going to put them on the plane. Now listen, all you got to do is want to go. You got to want to go. A man called me for the last two trips on the phone. Sister Carney, would you like to go to Israel? Oh, and I got a friend too. And so they paid for her too. They did. They paid for both of us just because I wanted a friend to go. Hallelujah. You go in there and get your inheritance. You got a place in Israel. The bride of Christ does. You're in the bride or not. How many are in the back? All right, then you gotta make this trip. You gotta make a trip to Israel. You have to go. Listen, it'll be left out of your mansion if you don't go. He wants to hang something in your mansion representing Israel. And you tell him, if you've been, Laura, you've been four times. Hallelujah. We had a house there for 28 years. We had 13 houses at one time. I'm not telling you something I don't know what I'm talking about. I'm telling you, if you had a choice of doing anything, you want to go to Israel. So LL has $1,200 of my money. They've locked down three times. And they told me if I don't ask for it back, they'll give me a ticket and a half. So I'm willing to share my ticket. The other half. And Bonnie has one too. I'll persuade her to give you the other half. Hallelujah. He that keepeth Israel will sing this and you're dismissed. Neither slumbers nor sleep. It's in the minor. Just any minor. C minor. He that keepeth Israel. Better bring it down to slumbers nor sleeps, slumbers nor sleeps, neither slumbers nor sleeps. He that keepeth Israel, neither slumbers nor sleeps, slumbers nor sleeps. Thank you. of you are going to sing songs that this river that you're singing today, when you get to heaven, is going to be music in your mansion. You're going to hear the strands of it playing through your mansion. How many are listening? It's going to play in your mansion. Tapestries of how God sees it's going to hang in your mansion. In your mansion, it's going to be your song of the Lord. We used to have a girl that did tapestries for every summer camp. They were the most beautiful tapestries you've ever seen. The work in it cost hundreds of dollars. But it was the song of the Lord. The song of the Lord. The song of the Lord. What do you call those things at the airport? They're up on a little pole, and they look like little round chutes, but they're wind barometers or something. You know what
they don't sock. Do? Huh? A wind sock.
What is that
a wind sock that tells you what the planes can see which way the wind is blowing when they get there.
I just saw that over you, Jill. You're going to see the way the winds are blowing. Yes! Woo! Oh, come on. How many want that? He said to Nicodemus, he said, you know the sun and all that coming up and you can feel the winds, but you don't know. You don't know. God wants us to know the mind of the Spirit. Come on, the way of the cloud, the way of the peace of the Lord, the way of the joy of the Lord, the way of the purposes of the Lord. Always know when God's getting ready to do something unusual in my life because I start doing this. Yeah. Like a child going to get ice cream. Yeah. I've seen my dog happier going to get ice cream and I've seen some things. Man, he's jumping up and down, licking, carrying on because I'm just going to give him a bite. But it tastes nice. And I do this. It's my spirit applauding God. He's getting ready to do something. Oh, I feel it. I feel it now. I feel it. I'm trying to get a little tour going. Anybody want to go on my tour if I can do something between now and April?
Yep.
Ooh, yeah. I won't charge much. I don't do it to make money. I don't do that. She got both hands up. Come on. I ought to call them and see what they'll give me a price for. Help me out here.
Amen.
We love your country, Israel. Now give me a good price. Hallelujah. Oh, Jesus. Woo, come on. Applaud him. Applaud him. Applaud him. He'll make it possible. And somebody will walk up to you, and they'll reach down in their pocket, and they'll say, I feel like I need to give you a little money. Come on. Generation. naked, you're going to make a way for every person in this room. Every person in this room. Every person that came to prayer today. Every person. Come on. Every person. Woo. Listen, one time I only had three men. This is the whole truth and nothing but the truth. One of them had dementia, and the other one was bipolar. I don't remember it. The rest of us were women. Wasn't that many? He was 25. I don't remember the other man. But we had four people in wheelchairs. Don't ask me how those three men pushed those four women. But they did. Pushed them all over Israel. Sometimes I'd push a little. Somebody else would push a little. Or sometimes one of them could walk. She'd get up. Virginia did it. She'd walk a little bit and get back in the wheelchair. She'd lost part of her foot. She had part of her foot removed. She had a hammer toe. But we only had, and one man had dementia. The other was bipolar. But it was my health. It's what God sent me. And they got the suitcases on and off of the bus. You know, you had to take them off. Yes. God does this and He'll take a cripple. It doesn't matter. They can be blind. He'll bring them by the way they know not of. Come on. Woo! I'm telling you, God can do everything, anything.
Yes.
And you take our cable card up to Masada.
Yeah.
Did you go up to Masada?
No.
Wasn't that something? I went up by cable car and walked it down. Can you believe that?
Wow.
Yes, I did.
Wow.
I'm going to do what I had done before. Hallelujah. Now they've made it like a city, but it's worth going. Oh, hallelujah. Glory to God. Lord, make it possible. Make it so.
Yes.
Make it, Lord. Put it in their heart till they can't get away from it. Night and day, burden their heart. While they're sleeping, when they wake up. I see God doing it. I'm seeing Rick jangle the keys over your head. I saw it over your head, sister in the back there. He's wanting you to go to Israel. Yes, you. Raise your hand if you know I'm talking to you. You, yeah. Yes. You believe it? You got to believe God wants you to go. You got to believe you'll take the right. Don't worry about the wardrobe. Just take what's comfortable, some good walking shoes. I remember a lady took a suitcase of flags with her. She waved up flags at every site we went to. Yes, it was her banners of God over her. Hallelujah. Yeah, that's right, Richard. Just let the orchestrations of what God wants. I see it. I see some of you going with your tomahawk. I don't know what that means, but.
Oh! Ah! Woo! Woo! Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
When you get there, I've seen more people kiss the ground. You don't know how many people. They used to, you couldn't go in the chute. They park on the tarmac, and then you had to get another bus to take you over to the doors because they were checking everybody's whistle, everybody's pen, everybody's hairspray, everybody's camera had to be. Yes. You had to click it. Now you can get off the plane right in the chute and go on down. It's become very commercial in there in the airport. Oh, they got any women, any kind of cream. And when people weren't coming, are you listening to me? I could buy $150 bottles of perfume for $25.
Yeah, it's a good time, right?
Because they didn't have any tourists. I got face creams like you can't believe from the